Hello everybody, can you hear me and see my screen okay today? All right, good. Got at least a couple yeses here. Let me wait just another couple minutes and make sure nobody else is going to be trickling in here, and then we will go ahead and get started. Did everybody receive the guidebook for today's webinar class? It should have been sent in the email an hour ago. I'll go ahead and add that in here to the chat box in case you did not receive that. Sorry about that, Clive. I will get that table of contents fixed for you guys. Sorry about that. All right, I guess I will go ahead and get started here. Looks like we're still missing a couple of people, but I don't want to make you guys sit around for too long, just in case they're not going to be showing up tonight. Tonight, I'm going to be teaching you guys HTML. For people that have not done HTML before, this can sometimes be a little bit confusing for the first time, but for people that are familiar with it, tonight should be a breeze for you guys. I'm going to be doing all of this in WordPress tonight, but one of the key things that I want you to remember here is that this doesn't only apply to WordPress. I'm simply doing this because I know that most of you guys are WordPress users, and so that is how the majority of my trainees are looking to learn how to do all this. But this HTML coding can definitely still be done in any website. To start with, I want to talk to you guys about some HTML basics first before I actually start diving into things. HTML is based on tags. Every tag has a name that goes along with it. And the tag name is simply enclosed in a less than and a greater than symbol. So for example, if I was creating a link tag, it is simply a less than symbol and the letter A and a greater than symbol, at least at the basis of it all. Every HTML tag will be surrounded in these greater than and less than symbols. And then sometimes you also have closing tags. Now, a closing tag is basically the same thing, except for you have an extra forward slash right here in front of the name of the tag. And what this is basically telling your website is that this is the beginning of the tag. Content that is located in between the two tags usually has something to do with the particular tag. In the case of a link, for example, the information that is in between your two tags will actually be the text that somebody clicks on for that link. Obviously, it could be things other than text. It could be images or even complicated HTML coding. But I'm going to try not to get into too much of the of the complicated aspects of it tonight, just so everybody actually has a good understanding of how HTML works. And then in the next two classes, I will actually be building on all these techniques that I'm discussing tonight. Tomorrow we'll be adding in CSS so we can change the design of all of this HTML. And then on the session after that, then we will be discussing PHP so you can actually build processing scripts and save information to databases. So this is really going to be kind of a three-part course, but at least with tonight, you should walk away with a good understanding of HTML. And a lot of these concepts, you can go ahead and take to your websites and start using them right away, even without the additional training the next couple of weeks. Next up, within some tags, you have what is called an attribute. Now, an attribute is essentially a variable for the tag, and this is providing extra information to HTML to usually control specifics about what the tag will actually do. Now, when it comes to a link tag, for example, one of the attributes that you will always use is the href attribute. And now this is always going to point to the website address that you want your link to point to when somebody clicks on it. Once you have typed in the attribute right here, href, as you can see, it's separated by a space from the actual tag name. At the end of the attribute, you have an equal sign. And then following that equal sign, you are going to have two quote marks. Now, these can either be single quotes or double quotes, but personally, I prefer to use the double quotes because then when I am doing programming such as PHP, I will often use single quotes, and it just makes it a lot easier to be able to mix HTML and PHP together when you're using a different quoting style for each of them. So then within these quotes, for the href tag, you actually want to put a complete website address. The reason why I say put a complete website address here is because you can actually put a relative website address in here. If you are wanting to point to pages that are on your own website, for example, you don't need the full website address, but you can actually use a relative address. So, for example, if you wanted to link up with another page that was on this site and you are working within another page here, you could simply leave all this off and just type in the name of the page here. For example, if I wanted to link back to this same page that is on this site right here, 50-2, I just simply type this in between these quote marks right here. So just as an example, I will show you guys how this will work. I'm going to create a link back to a website of my own here. Now before I actually show you how this works, I'm going to explain a couple more things about links here. To start with, one of them is another attribute called target. Now, the target attribute is not necessarily required in every given link because there is a default value for this. For example, when you click on a link, when it does not have a target attribute specified, then that link simply loads the new website within the same window that you are working on. But sometimes you might want to keep your website visitors actually on your page and simply load up a website address within a completely new window, for example. To do this, you use the target attribute. This works just like the href attribute as well. You have the attribute name, you have an equal sign, and then you have double quote marks. And then the value of the attribute is actually going to go in between your quote marks here. Now to make a link open up into a new window, you want to use the value of underscore blank. In the guidebook, I've actually gone over four different potential attribute values that you can use. There are also basically an infinite number of additional attribute values that can be used for the target attribute, but these are not commonly used. They are customized names of frames that you have built into your website, and frames really aren't as heavily used these days as they once were. So the majority of the time you guys will either be using the default value of target, in which case you can simply leave it off of your links, or if you want to open into a new window, then just use the blank target. And then the additional steps that you have to take to make your link work are really fairly simple. All you have to do is just add in the text or the image, or you could actually add a text and an image in between your two tags here. And whatever you type in, this is going to be the clickable link text, what is also known as anchor text for your link. Now I'm going to go ahead and publish this this simple link here just to show you exactly how this looks in person. Of course, my page is not coming up. There we go. I think I opened it up a little early before it was done publishing. Now, as you can see, it just creates a simple link here with the text that I entered in between the link tags, and you click on it, and then it opens up the website address that I typed in into a completely new window. As you can see, people could then return back to your page here and continue navigating. And a lot of times this is helpful if you're promoting, for example, affiliate products, because there are a lot of times when people will click on links and visit another website and just simply get caught up in doing something on that website, and then they just forget to return to your site, or maybe they can't even find their way back. So this is one example of a way that you can help to retain the visitors on your website. Now, to expand on this a little bit more, I'm actually going to talk about the image tag next. Now, an image tag, it works just like any other HTML tag. You have your opening and your closing less than and greater than symbol, and then you simply put the name of the tag in between those two symbols. And for an image tag, you simply use the letters IMG. Now, in addition to this, you have attributes that are required for an image. There is actually only one of them, which is the SRC attribute. Now, the easiest way to understand the SRC attribute is to basically compare it to the href attribute of a link. The SRC attribute is going to point to a website address where an image can be found on your website. It could also be where an image is found on a completely different website, for example. You can see here that I'm on this website, Down Comforter Guide, but then I could go to a completely different website, Ryan Stevenson Plugins, for example, and I could actually take one of these images and simply copy the image location and then paste it in between my quote marks here. And it gives the full path to an image file that's not even located within my website, although it can definitely be an image also located on your site. Now, this alone will actually already produce a completely finalized image HTML tag. I'm going to go ahead and refresh the page here just so you can see it in action. Now, sometimes people want to show an image on their site, but perhaps maybe they don't like the size of the image, and maybe they don't either use graphics editing software or want to open it up. And you can actually just use HTML to quickly resize an image for you. All you have to do is use the width and the height attributes, and then simply provide a number in between the quote marks again that represents, these numbers represent the number of pixels, both in width here and in height, that you would like for the image to get displayed in. Now, one thing that is very important to remember here is that you simply need to keep the numbers the same, ratios. Now, let me show you real quick here. I'm going to go back to this site where I got this image from and do this a little slower for you here. If you right-click on View Image Info down here, and look at the dimensions. This is in the Firefox browser that I am using. You can see here that it tells me the original dimensions of the image is 350 pixels by 350 pixels. So when I am setting a new size for the image that I want to use, I want to make sure that I maintain that same ratio, or else my image will end up distorted. Now, just to show you what I'm talking about here, I'm actually going to enter in a bad ratio here, just so you can see exactly what I'm talking about. I have changed the height down to 125, whereas the width is still set at a higher number at 250. So when I refresh the page here, that actually doesn't look too horrible because of the particular image. But as you can see, it made it smaller. And certain images that you are dealing with, when you start to stretch them out, in width or in a vertical manner, it can definitely distort your image and end up completely messing up the way that it looks on your site. Just to show you one more attribute here. Now, this is not very commonly used anymore, but if you find that your images are having a border placed around them and you don't want that border to be there, that border could be controlled by CSS, but it could also be controlled by HTML as well. Using the border attribute, you can set a width of a border, or you can actually set that width to the number of zero to simply force the border to be removed. Now, one other thing, it's not absolutely essential to do this, but the image tag here is actually what is known as a self-closing HTML tag. You can see that it has this opening tag here, but there is not a closing tag like there is for the link tag, for example. You have your opening tag up here, and you have your closing tag back here. Now, with self-closing tags, certain HTML types will actually, when you're using, for example, a strict HTML validation, you will actually want to ensure that you use a forward slash at the end of all of your self-closing tags. Now, all you have to do is just add an extra space and a forward slash right here before the closing greater than symbol. Just to show you one more thing to expand on the link before here, I have actually gone ahead and copied the image HTML that I created here, and I'm moving it up above into this link. Now, I have still left the text here on this page, Ryan Stevenson Plugins. But now I have added an additional HTML tag, which is self-closing, so I have added on the space and the forward slash to the end of it. This is the break tag. This creates a line break, so it will have this text on one line, and it will have the next part of this HTML coding drop down to the next line. So now what this is going to actually create is both the text and the image will then be contained within this this link that I have created. I'm going to refresh this page, and you can see now that the text here is still linked up, but then the image is also a link now as well. This is a way that you can kind of expand on your HTML links a little bit more. You don't have to simply have a little bit of text within the link. You can actually use HTML coding inside of your links to make them, you know, look fancier or to simply be able to do more with them. You could create two separate HTML links, one for the text and another one for the image, but there's typically not much of a point in doing so when those links will be sitting right next to each other on the page. You can just consolidate them into one single link here. Before I proceed, does anybody have any questions so far on using HTML links or images, or even just any questions about perhaps the basics of HTML, how all of this works? If you would like to ask anything at all before I proceed from here, feel free to go ahead and do so, just so I don't get too far ahead and leave you guys behind with questions. I realized that last week, I don't think I actually stopped for questions until I hit the very end of the evening. So I thought I would try to avoid doing so again tonight. Just to explain a little bit more here before I proceed, just to give you guys a little bit of time to ask some questions if you have them. A lot of this HTML can actually be done through WordPress itself. For example, you have a link button here where you can enter in the destination URL. You can even click this box here to open the link in a new window and add the link. As you can see, this is essentially created the same link up above here minus the actual text inside of the link. So you can use parts of WordPress up here to help you with this HTML coding. And a lot of people may think, you know, well, if it's already here in WordPress, then why do I actually need to learn it? And the reason being is that, you know, within WordPress will not be the only place that you will ever have the need to use HTML coding. And when you're using all of this and creating this HTML coding, a lot of people simply just don't understand what they are looking at. And if they want to make changes to particular parts of the coding that WordPress has created for them, then they'll actually find that it can be difficult to do so because they simply don't understand it. They might try to edit part of it and end up causing errors as a result. And then there are other situations where you might find that you'll need HTML if you're doing anything on external websites, Web 2.0 properties like Squidoo, for example. You can actually use HTML on a lot of these other websites, and they may not already have easy built-in ways for you to do so. One last example is actually within widgets. You can build text widgets and add HTML coding into those as well. but that will not actually have this little toolbar up here for you. Will, the forward slash before the last greater than sign, right here. This is a self-closing tag. I'm trying not to get into too much of the horribly technical aspect of it for you guys. But there are different types of HTML coding, basically. And when you are viewing a web page, let me show you really quick here. When you view the page source, you can see up at the top a doc type is actually set. And for WordPress, it is just set as doc type HTML, at least with the theme that I am using. But sometimes other themes may actually change the doc type that is being used. Now, I don't really want to go into too much detail about that because I could probably go on for that for a good hour or more about doc types and HTML validation. But essentially, it all comes down to HTML code validation. This line break tag right here, for example, I could also type it like this without the space and the forward slash at the end of it. And on the majority of websites, either one of them will actually work correctly and not cause any problems. However, the reason why I prefer to teach the second format down here with the forward slash is simply because if you do happen to be using a WordPress theme that is using other doc types, perhaps a strict HTML doc type, these tags right here that do not have the forward slash on the end will not actually validate as being proper HTML coding, whereas this tag will validate properly, and the image tag up here where I have closed it off. Essentially, any time that you are using an HTML tag, if there is not a matching closing tag to go along with the opening tag, then you should close it off using a space and a forward slash. And this will just simply help to avoid validation problems with your coding. Most people typically don't even realize that this is going on or worry about it. But it is typically accepted knowledge that Google will attempt to validate the HTML coding on your website. So I do try to teach it in a way that will actually validate for you guys. The next thing that I'm going to be teaching you guys tonight is HTML list. Now a list is also something that can be done directly through WordPress here. You have the UL and the OL and the LI tags. All three of these different tags are all used for HTML lists. If you're on the visual tag over here and you're not actually looking at the HTML coding on your site, the tags are then consolidated for the list into two instead of three different buttons. You have the unordered list and the ordered list. So I'm actually going to be teaching you guys how you can use these and the difference between the two of them. To start with, I'm going to do the ordered list. Now, in ordered list, what this is going to do is you have different items of information that are within a list. and each of these are displayed on their own line. And with a numbered list, it will automatically number each of the items going down the list for you in ascending numerical order. So the first item on the list will have the number 1 by it automatically. And you don't even have to type in the numbers for the text. If you decide to rearrange things, it will automatically assign the correct letters along with everything for you. Now, to start the ordered list, I'm using the OL tag up here. Now, you never use the OL tag and the UL tag together, at least not in the sense of it being the same list. I will show you an example here in just a little bit where I'm actually going to use them together, but that is not in a simple list format. With an ordered list, you actually will only use the OL and the LI tags. Now, to start it off with, you want an opening OL tag, and then you need an opening LI tag. And all you simply have to do is type in the text that you want for your first list item to be displayed right here. Now you can type all this HTML coding in manually. As you can see, I've put a closing tag on the end here. Or you can also use these WordPress buttons. You can see that once I have created an opening tag, that it actually changes the text up here and includes a forward slash on the end of it, indicating that I then need to close off the tag. I find that these more basic HTML concepts, the ones where WordPress actually provides some of these buttons for you, can actually be some of the easier concepts to begin learning with, because if you're not quite sure of what you should be doing, then you can usually use this stuff for reference or to simply get it to help you out with your coding. Now, I'm going to go ahead and create a second list item on here just to show you exactly how this works. Now, once I'm done with all the list items that I want to have included in this list, then I simply close off the list here with a closing tag matching my opening tag. I'm going to go ahead and update this page here and refresh it so you can see what this does on my website. You can see down here it has added those two bits of text that I typed in, and it has put a number 1 and a number 2 next to each of the items in the list. As you can see, this really isn't even built into the actual text of my website. You can see here, as I try to select these numbers right here, it doesn't actually select these numbers, because really this is the only text that I have added to my website. All of this is being generated by HTML for me. Now to go back and show you the other type of list real quick here, this is an unordered list, and the only difference between an ordered list and an unordered list in the HTML coding, at least, is simply the opening tag that you use. I have changed the OL into a UL tag on both the opening and the closing tag. Now I can update the changes here and go back to view my website and see exactly how this changes the list. You can see that the items are still listed here just like they were before, but instead of using numbers, I am now using these bullet points. Now, once we get into CSS tomorrow, I will actually be showing you guys how you can actually change these bullet points right here. There are a number of different styles that you can use. And this also applies to the ordered list as well. You can change the numbers into things like letters or even Roman numerals, for example, Or you could even completely change it to where it doesn't show anything at all, or maybe it shows a custom image, for example. If you've ever seen lists like this that are built on a web page, and they have maybe some kind of arrow or check mark beside them that appears to be an image file, this is how they have done it. It's by using lists, and then they will simply add some CSS coding to the list to change these bullet points into an image file instead. So I'll be revisiting that again in the next session next week for you guys to show exactly how that works. To go a little bit deeper here with the list, I want to create a nested list for you real quick. Now, a nested list is basically it's putting one list inside of another list. Now, with a nested list, you can use either the unordered or the ordered list, and this is actually one situation where you could mix the two together, but only when it's done in the proper manner. Now, when you want to have a nested list, the first thing that you need to do is to ensure that your second list is included in the proper location within your original list. This should always be done somewhere within an opening and a closing LI tag. So your new list will actually be part of one of the list items from the other list. All you have to do is essentially do the same thing that you did before, except now you are doing it a second time within this list. So this one would be my first nested list item. I forgot my opening tag. Opening tag and a closing tag. And then I will create a second nested list item and a closing tag. And now I'm going to add a closing tag for my list, for my second nested list. You can see the opening tag right here and the closing tag right here. And this is all included in between the list tags of my original list. Now I will update the changes here to show this to you again so you can see what this does. And you can see that it actually adds an extra indentation right here for my nested list. So these items in my nested list then fall underneath the item that I have added this list at the bottom of. You can see that the list here is at the bottom of the first list item, and that's exactly where it shows up here on the site, and it essentially becomes a child list of this particular list item. Now, like I was saying before, you can mix and match your nested list. You could have one of them being an ordered list and one of them being an unordered list, for example. To refresh the changes here, you can see that I made the original list an ordered list, so this will count down 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on. And then the nested list is still unordered, and it will use the bullet points. Using this simple HTML for creating lists, you can actually create content on your sites that is less boring and more eye-appealing. If you ever find that when you're looking at another website and you're perhaps scanning through the page, large paragraphs of text, for example, are really easy to quickly scan over and pass them by. But when you hit an HTML list like this, it typically tends to catch the eye, and you will often stop and at least read a couple of items in the list before moving on. So I find that a HTML list is a good way to break up the monotony of a simple website article, for example. Take some of the information in an article or about a particular subject and, you know, break it down into an outline, essentially, and create that outline using these HTML lists. And you can make your pages a lot more visually appealing in that manner, at least. Now, when it comes to using the nested list, there really are not any limits to how many times you can nest a list within another list. You could have, you know, many, many, many different nested lists. I could break this second one down right here and add another one in right here in between this set of LI tags. Essentially, any set of LI tags that you have within your list, then you could add another nested list within inside of that one. So there's really kind of an unlimited amount of possibilities in terms of the way that you could create different types of lists using this technique. Now before I proceed on from lists and jump into the next subject, does anybody have any questions about creating an HTML list or anything else that I have gone over? Perhaps a question about using the nested list, for example. After that, I will be going on to teaching you guys some basics about using HTML to change the style of your text. While I'm waiting for questions, I can at least go ahead and explain a little bit about that to you guys. Typically, HTML it was not intended to be used for actually designing your website. HTML is really the structure and the frame for your website, and then the designing actually takes place within CSS coding, which you know, once again, I will be getting into in greater detail tomorrow night or next week for you guys in the next session. But with that said, there are some commonly used HTML tags that can actually work with changing the design of your website or simply changing the way that text looks on your website. There are a lot more of these design altering HTML tags beyond the ones that I'm going to be discussing tonight. But I really did not want to get into too much detail about those particular design tags, simply because using CSS is a much better and easier way to do it. So I really just wanted to focus on some of the basics of styling with HTML, at least in the regards of some of the common tags that I often find myself using. Now, 9 times out of 10, these same things can still be accomplished using CSS, but there are some easier ways to do it using HTML for a couple of particular design tags. I guess since I don't have any questions so far on using the HTML list, so I will actually go ahead and proceed on here to start talking about using these styles. Now, two of them that I'm going to discuss can be found up here in the WordPress toolbar. This is the B tag, which is used for making text bold. But now, when you click on the B tag, you actually notice that it didn't add a B tag to my text. It actually added strong tags, both an opening and a closing tag to my text. Now, on some websites, the B tag and the strong tag could actually do the exact same thing in terms of what it's going to make the text look like on your page. However, there is actually a major difference between these two tags, which is another reason why I wanted to spend at least a little bit of time discussing this with you guys. Now, the main difference is that the strong tag is really a semantic version of the B tag. Now, what that means is that the B tag was only intended to be used for display styling purposes, whereas the strong tag is indicating that there is some kind of significance with the text that is in between the strong tags. And under a default behavior, it will then also make that text bold. However, CSS coding can definitely change this. So if you find that you place the strong tags around text and it does not actually make your text bold, it is likely because of the CSS coding, perhaps within your WordPress theme, for example. I'm going to refresh the page here. You can see that I made this top item in the list here. I put the strong tags around it, and using the theme that I use on most of my WordPress sites, which is actually the Weaver 2 theme. It's a free theme that you can find by just searching for it through WordPress. This theme, by default, will make text bold that has the strong tags placed around it. Now, just to show you, I'm going to switch out strong for bold here and refresh my page. Now, as you can see, there was absolutely no change whatsoever. So from a website visitor's perspective, there may not be any difference whatsoever between using a B tag and a strong tag. However, the reason why I really wanted to talk about these two different tags is because there is one instance that it can make a difference, and that actually involves search engines like Google, for example. They will look at certain tags that are within the content of your pages, tags that are intended to be semantic HTML tags, and they will use these tags to help to gain an understanding about what your websites are about. So as a marketer, when you are building your websites, you can actually use this to your advantage by adding tags like strong tags, for example, around certain words or parts of text within your content to essentially place an emphasis on that particular text and say that, you know, this is important text that is within all of this content. And so when you are identifying important text that is relational to the subject of the page that you are creating, then you help to create a semantic relationship there, and it helps search engines like Google, for example, to understand what your pages are about, and ultimately, in the end, this can result in better search engine rankings. Now, one, I guess with all of that said, one other thing that is very, very important to understand here is that certain tactics like these, using semantic tags, for example, to highlight maybe your target keyword phrase within the content of one of your articles, while it is a good tactic that you can use, you have to be very careful with using this tactic too much, and also with creating a sort of spam scenario within the content of one of your web pages. Just as an example, if you were targeting, say, the phrase down comforter guide, and you wrote a 500-word article, and every time down comforter guide, the phrase, appeared within that content, if you set strong tags around that and no other content with on that, you know, that was on that page, and so maybe you had 3, 4, 5, 6 different strong tags surrounding your target keyword phrase, that could easily be interpreted as keyword spam by Google. And so when you think you may be creating content that has a good potential to get a good search engine ranking, you can actually end up doing more harm than good if you overuse these tactics. So typically, I recommend if you're wanting to highlight a particular keyword phrase on one of your pages on your website, for example, just do it one time somewhere within the content of the page. Now, you can use the strong tag, for example, more than one time within the content of the page, but you just want to make sure that you're not placing that emphasis on the same exact keyword or keyword phrase over and over again. So you could place an emphasis on other words that are relational to your target phrase, but you don't want to repeatedly emphasize your target phrase over and over again to avoid getting flagged for keyword spam once again. Now, to go a little bit further here, I'm going to go to this next item here, which is to make text into italics, and I'm going to delete my bold tags off of this item and apply the same effect here to this list item. Now, as you can see, even though it says I right here for italics, and I is the italic HTML tag, it has created a tag called EM. EM is essentially just like the strong tag again here. This is another semantic tag, whereas the I tag is simply for display and styling purposes only. So just like with the bold tag, you could choose to use either I or EM, but you know, just be sure to use EM responsibly, and don't, you know, over target your keyword phrases with emphasis using these particular tags. Now, once again, by default, your EM tag and the I tag should produce the same result on a web page. You can see I have refreshed this, and this first list item down here, it is now with italic text. Another thing here, you can actually combine these tags. You could set a strong tag around the EM tag that is already in place. So now this bit of text right here is surrounded by two different tags. It has these opening tags to the left, and it has these closing tags to the right. Updating the changes once again, this will produce italic text that is also bold. So you can mix and match these different combinations of styling HTML tags to get the desired effect that you are looking for. And once again, this is really only basic styling. When you want to get into more complicated styling, like changing the size or the colors or the locations of your text, you want to do all of that using CSS coding, which once again I will be getting into next week for you guys. Now, proceeding on to the next item that I would like to talk about tonight is yet another display tag, and this is the underline display tag. Now, this just uses the letter U, and if you update the changes on the site here, you can see that it didn't update. Okay, so now the item is simply underlined for me, and I removed the bold and italic that was placed on it before. And as you can see, the bold and italic tags are also included here at the top of the WordPress toolbar, whether you are in the visual or the text tag. Obviously, the visual tag excludes all the HTML from it, whereas the text tag, you get to see all the HTML coding that is affecting everything. So the next tag that I want to show you, and this is I guess the last styling tag that I would like to talk to you guys about, is actually the S tag. Now, the S tag is for a strike through effect. Now, all this does is it essentially takes the underline that is under a word and it just moves it right up into the middle of the word. So you have a line running straight through the center of the text. You can see I update the changes, and this line is now running straight through the center of the text. Now, there are a lot of instances where you could actually use the strike-through effect, and a lot of people initially might think, why would I want to create text on my site and then strike through it to make it harder to read? One particular example of a way that people will use this strike-through effect is for prices, for example. I'm sure a lot of you guys have seen special offers, for example, where it will show you one price and that price is slashed out, and then below it is the real price that you get to pay today. So, you know, as an affiliate marketer, when you're promoting other products, you can use this technique to increase the implied value in a product. People think this product is normally selling for $100 and I can get it today for $67, you know, that's a pretty nice discount. So the strike-through effect is most commonly used when it comes to numbers and prices, at least for marketers, it typically is. Now, does anybody have any questions on any of the styling tags that I have just gone through and discussed? And if not, then I will go ahead and move on to the next topic. I'll go ahead and start discussing this a little bit here, and if you guys have questions, feel free to chime in at any time. You don't have to wait for me to stop and ask you for questions. If you do hear me talk about something or see something that you have a question about, feel free to go ahead and type it in at any time you want. The next thing that I would like to discuss tonight is a difference between two fundamental types of HTML tags. You have what are known as inline and block elements. Now, an element in HTML is simply nothing more than a tag or a set of tags, for example. One tag that you may have seen used before is the div tag, div. The div tag has an opening and a closing tag. Now a div tag is actually a block element. And what this means is that when a web browser is looking at the HTML on a page and it's scanning through all of the code that needs to be processed to be displayed on the site, it is looking for block elements and inline elements to determine where that information or text should be located on the website. Now, when you're just going along and typing standard text into a web page, for example, all of that text shows up next to each other. It does not automatically drop down to a new line on the page each time. But with block elements automatically create a new line, and anything after those block elements will then also be created on another new line. So the block element, think of it as you drop a block element on a page and it stretches out its arms in either direction to take up all the possible space that it can take up. So it's not going to allow anything else to show up on the page next to it. It's either going to be above it or it's going to be down below it. Whereas an inline element is actually going to be the opposite of that. It will not create new lines. It is simply going to be displayed next to everything that it is next to within your coding. An easy way to think of an inline element is simply text that is on your page. When you type two words in an article next to each other, those words do not automatically drop down onto a new line with each word. All of those words are displayed next to each other instead of on new lines. I'm going to get into some specific examples of using some of these different block and inline elements here. Some of the most common ones, I guess the most important one that I should teach you, is the paragraph tag. Now, this gets an opening tag and a closing tag, and it simply uses the letter P. Now, when you add content into one of these tags, and then you have, say, another paragraph tag directly below it, what this is actually going to do is create each of these sentences on separate lines. Now, you might be thinking, well, WordPress will do this for me automatically, but I'm going to put them both up here on the same line. I think I am logged out of my site here. I'm not quite sure why it did that. Let me get back into this page here. And it has wiped out my changes. I'll just go ahead and retype this real quick. Okay, so I have two paragraph tags, and they are going to be one right next to the other. And then we can see how this looks on the live web page. Updating my changes, and you can see down here at the bottom that these sentences are displayed one after the other with blank space in between them. Even though up here, I actually put this information all on the same line. Another thing, I guess one of the main reasons why I really, really wanted to talk about the paragraph tag in particular is not necessarily that it's a tag that you guys will use a lot, but whether you realize it or not, this is actually a tag that WordPress is automatically using. I have viewed the source of this page that I am viewing here just to show you guys exactly what I am referring to. If you see right here at the top of my content, you can see that there is a paragraph tag. Here automatically, even though I didn't type this paragraph tag right here at the beginning of my content. Now there is also even more paragraph tags throughout this text here. You can see there's a closing tag here, there's another opening tag here, another closing tag here, and the reason why these paragraph tags are here is because of the way that the WordPress editor works. You're used to simply being able to come into the WordPress editor and type the text that you need, and when you want to start a new line, you just hit enter a couple of times and start typing your text out on a new line. Well, what WordPress is doing is they're actually looking at all of the content on your page, and they're automatically adding in these paragraph tags for you whenever you have essentially used the enter key to create a new line. Now, the reason why it is extremely important to know about WordPress creating these automatic tags is because if you go into WordPress and you start creating your own custom HTML or CSS coding or maybe even JavaScript, for example, if you've ever copied code from another website and tried to paste it in to one of your WordPress pages and the code didn't work maybe at all or as it was intended to work, this automatic paragraph processing that WordPress does can actually be the reason why it did not work. Now, without going into actual coding, PHP coding today, there is a simple way that you can do it. I will show you guys another way that you can do it 2 weeks from now when I do the PHP lesson. I will show you how you can simply use a little bit of PHP coding to simply disable that processing completely, but only on one specific page of your website. But tonight I want to show you non-coding methods that can be used to do this. Now, if you're using the Weaver 2 theme, like I am using on my site, if you scroll down below the page content here, you can see that there is a large section down here for options. One of these options here is allow raw HTML and scripts, disables auto paragraph, texturize, and other processing. Now, this checkbox right here, you can check this and update your page, and it will then automatically not add those paragraph lines into your text. You can see if I update the changes, you can see that certain elements on my page here are now displaying next to each other instead of one above the other because that paragraph processing has been removed from it. Typically, you might think, well, okay, that looks like it did the trick. Why can't I just use that all the time? The thing is, if you are using other plugins on your site, for example, Let's say you're using a plugin that creates some kind of short code on your page. Now, a short code, I use them in a number of my plugins, like Product Style, for example, or Combos On, for example. You create the advertisement, and then you select the advertisement that you want to insert into your page, and it inserts a short little bit of text that might look something like this. And this actually represents one of these saved advertisements in a plugin. Now, if you have a page that is using any kind of short code like this, for my plugins or anybody else's plugins for that matter, if you are using this checkbox down here, then these short codes will not get processed. This is what this last little bit here, other processing, is actually referring to things such as this. Short code conversion is one of the other processing steps that WordPress will automatically apply to your pages. So if you are using short codes on your site, you will not be able to use this checkbox down here because it will cause your short codes to stop working correctly. And you will simply see the short code that is in your text. It will simply get displayed on your live website. So another way that you can avoid the automatic processing, besides using this checkbox and also besides using PHP programming, is to simply remove all of the blank space within HTML coding, CSS coding, or JavaScript coding even. You can see here I am simply going to the beginning of each of my lines and deleting until it takes me back to the beginning of the next line. This is started over on a new line here since I've filled it up. And so once I have done this, you can see that I have combined all of the HTML coding on this page into technically one line. It wraps to multiple lines, obviously, because WordPress doesn't stretch out to the side to show you your content. But this is essentially all getting outputted on one single line. So now if I update that content and then go back to view the changes on my page, you can see that it actually stayed the same for me as it was before, even though I now have this auto paragraph. Still, it's re-enabled on this page. All I have done is consolidate all of my coding into a single line, and then WordPress doesn't automatically apply those new paragraph tags to it like it was doing before. You can see that it will still apply paragraph tags sometimes to your content, even when you have combined it like this. And if you see any of those tags, just go back into your coding and ensure that you have removed all of the white space from your HTML coding to ensure that everything shows up properly. Now, this may not seem very important right away, but if you get to where you are copying code off of other sites and trying to paste it into your site, to make some changes to it, for example, then this is something that can save you a ton of headaches eventually in the future, because it is something that I have personally had to deal with myself. If you are, for example, using Google Analytics code or AWeber newsletter code, for example, say you create a newsletter form and you want to paste that into your page, with that auto paragraph processing there, it's simply not going to work correctly. It might still display everything that was supposed to be there, but it might not it might not look entirely correct because you're within your CSS coding, which is listed, you know, one line after the next. WordPress will be adding paragraph tags to your CSS coding, which just completely messes all of it up. So that's why this auto paragraph feature can actually break stuff when it's not something that you are familiar with or trying to look out for. The next thing that I would like to discuss, I'm going to go back and I mentioned the div tag previously. I'm going to change these paragraph tags into div tags here and then update the changes on my page. As you can see, the extra space that was in between these two sentences has now been removed. And this happens because the CSS coding on a div tag will be set typically on most people's websites to not have a top or a bottom margin, whereas paragraph tags do have a margin, and it creates that extra blank space. Whereas a div tag, it is still a block element, just like a paragraph tag is, but it simply works in a different manner because this one is not creating as much extra space on your site. So when you want two elements to be actually butting right up against each other, above and below, you can use a div tag. If you place two images within these div tags, the images will actually touch right here in this center. You may or may not have noticed before, but some people actually build and design the layout of their websites in this manner. They will connect a bunch of div tags together, and each tag might have an image within it or being used as the background of it. And then they simply butt right up next to each other, and it may look like one large connected image when in fact it's actually a bunch of smaller pieces of individual images that are just coming together as a whole to make one particular design, for example. Now, the div tag is something that I am going to discuss in a lot more detail when it comes to next week's CSS lesson, because this is one of the most commonly used HTML tags. You can actually build an entire website, the layout of the website at least, with nothing but div tags and CSS coding to rearrange everything and to you know, determine exactly how everything is going to look on your site. So I'll be getting into more of that next week again for you guys. The next tag that I would like to talk about are is actually a series of six different tags, and these are what are known as header tags. Now there are actually, like I said, six of them, and they number all the way from 1 to number 6. And all you simply do is put the letter H in front of the number. So you have H1, H2, H3, and so on all the way down to H6. Now, a header tag is also a block element, except the header tag also has semantic meaning within it. Google, for example, will often look at your header tags to determine the main subjects that each of your pages is about. So once again, you want to ensure that header tags are being used in the correct manner on your site. What I'm actually doing here is I'm going to create one of each of the different header tags for you guys here, just so you can see some initial differences between these. Now, if you were just to create a completely blank HTML page and use these header tags, you might notice that the text sizes for the lowered numbered tags, H1 and H2, for example, the text size is actually rather enormous. I honestly can't see there being many practical situations where you would actually want to use text that is that large. However, most WordPress themes have actually added CSS coding for the different headers, and so it's not going to be as bad. And these results can actually change from one website to the next. If you type in the same string of header code right here on your website, it could look completely different from this because it's being controlled by CSS coding. But you can see here from this example that each of the earlier sentences in general is larger text than the higher numbered sentences that are down at the bottom. And this is simply because the headers are typically used, like I was saying, in a semantic manner to understand what exactly your website is about. So your H1 tag on a particular page would typically represent your primary topic on that page, whereas then your H2 tag might be referring to perhaps a subtopic on the page. And then you have even more headers going down from there that you could use to further expand on that principle there. But the main thing that you want to remember is that on most websites, you actually already have a H1 tag and an H2 tag already in use, at least in most cases. Now, once again, this is going to heavily vary depending on the theme that you are using for your site. But for this particular theme, the Weaver theme, you can see right here that there is a H1 tag and there is an H2 tag. But the other header tags that are here on this page, I believe the only other one that it is using, I want to say, here's another H1 tag. This theme is actually using an H1 tag for the title of the page that I am building, and then it has another H1 tag for the title of the site, and then it uses an H2 tag for the site description. Now, personally, I actually like to have this as my header one tag, the subject, the title of the specific page that I am building. I like for that to be my H1 tag, but then I will typically want my site title to be an H2 tag, and usually I will include the site description with that as well. And this theme actually offers some additional options for changing those header tags around. Worst case, you can even go into the actual HTML coding for a theme and simply reverse the H1 and H2 tags if you would like to change that around. The only problem with doing that is that you will then also have to switch the relating CSS coding as well, or else you might find that one part of the text is larger than you were expecting it to be, because typically H1 will be larger text and H2 will be smaller text. But the main idea here, in terms of using header tags on your live websites, if you don't want to fool with whatever your theme is doing for the header tags, you can simply use the header tags within your content. Think about all of the secondary subjects that you discuss throughout a particular article that you have written on a web page, for example. And you could pick out a main idea out of maybe every paragraph or every couple of paragraphs and assign some type of header text to be displayed above that paragraph, which basically acts as, you know, a summary for that paragraph. And once again, since these are semantic tags, you can use these for keyword targeting, just like I was talking about with the strong and the EM tags before. But this is yet again another example where you have to be extremely careful in terms of how often you are emphasizing particular keyword phrases, especially your target keyword phrase. Now, the next thing that I would like to go on to is discussing the other kind of element, which is an inline element. Now, with an inline element, as I briefly mentioned before, it essentially acts as though it is just another word within your article, for example. And so your inline tags will not automatically create a new line within the content of your pages. There are actually a lot more inline tags than there are block tags, because most of your standard HTML tags, like a link tag or an image tag, for example, or any of the styling tags that I was discussing before, all of these tags don't automatically create a new line in your content, and so they are considered to be inline tags. Now, the reason why it's good to know the difference between a block and an inline tag is because you need to know which ones to use within your site content at the right times. If you don't want a new line to be created, obviously you don't want to be using block elements when you could simply use an inline element to accomplish the same task, but to have your information display where you actually want it to display. For this example, the span tag is one particular tag that I will find myself commonly using. I actually use the div tag and the span tag very, very frequently when I am building my web pages, because they are easy to alter with CSS coding. Now, my intentions in this particular lesson are not to get into too much CSS coding. But for this particular example, I am going to do a very quick example of CSS coding just so I can show you exactly how these inline elements work. Now, within the span tag, I have added an attribute called style. Style is the attribute that you use when you would like to add CSS coding to a specific element of your page. This is referred to as inline CSS, not because it is an inline element, but because the CSS is done inline with the rest of your coding instead of being located in a separate file, for example. I will teach you guys about doing that type of stuff again next week, but just for today's example, what I would like to do is to use a couple of spans right here Just to quickly alter something about this text, and also to show you how this could be useful to use the inline elements when they don't force a new line to be created. If I were to use div tags here instead of span tags, it would drop this word and this word onto new lines, and then the words that came after that would also be on yet another new line. So I don't want all of these words in this sentence to be split up. I still want them to be within a sentence, but perhaps I want to apply a particular style to one specific word that is in my sentence. Inline elements is how you actually accomplish that. So when I have updated these changes here that I've made on my site, you can see I've only added it to the first and the second sentence here. In the first sentence, I have changed the word first from standard black text into blue text. And with second, I have changed this into red text. And yet the HTML element or the tag that I added in surrounding the word first and the word second, this didn't cause it to drop to a new line because they are inline elements and not block elements. And once again, that will become a lot more important next week when it is time to dive into using CSS a lot more. Once again, if anybody has any questions, feel free to chime in at any time and ask whatever you would like about anything I have gone over so far. And if not, I will just keep continuing on. It looks like I might actually be on target tonight to run a little bit over the projected end time. However, I don't have a problem doing so for you guys. My point is to make it through all of the content that I've planned on teaching you guys and not necessarily to stick to specific time constraints, because I obviously would not want to skip something just to save 10 minutes, for example. The next thing that I'm going to discuss is HTML tables. Now, before CSS came along and was commonly used, a lot of people used tables, myself included, to actually design the layout of web pages, because a table creates everything in rows and columns, and you can specify the size of each of the individual cells within any of the rows or columns. So what this basically means is that you can create a grid pattern using a table, and that grid can be laid out in any dimensions that you want to, and specific blocks within the grid can even be different sizes from all of the other blocks within the grid. So what people would do is they would create a multi-column table and essentially use that to control their website layout. For example, just to go back over to this main page here, if a table were controlling this content, down here, for example, I might have one column of the table that held all of the content, all of the article content for my page, and then another column of the table might contain all of my widgets over here. And these will always line up down the right-hand side of the page, no matter how few or how many there are over there. So this is just one example of at least how tables used to be used. Some people do still try to use them that way, but honestly, you can achieve that same effect using CSS and div tags instead. The only exception when I will actually use a table instead of a div tag and CSS is when I want my columns within my content to have a predefined width. Now with a table, it will automatically resize everything for you to fit the amount of content that is in your table, unless you have specified particular numbers. But the key part is that it keeps everything aligned into specific columns. And those columns, the content within those columns, always remains aligned. You can accomplish that with a div tags and CSS. However, if you are really, really in a situation where you need those cells to be a specific size, sometimes a div tag and CSS combination may not work exactly the way you would like for them to work. So in that instance, I do believe it is still okay to use table HTML to control the design of something, but I always use it as a last resort, essentially. Now, to create a table, you simply use the tag name table, and you have both an opening tag and a closing tag for your table. And now everything, all of the information and data for the table will all be contained in between these two particular tags. Now, as you know, a table has columns that are running up and down, and then it also has rows that are running horizontally from left to right. A table is always created one row at a time. You don't create it down each column, you create it each row going across, and then you move down to the next row below it. So a row is actually created using the tag TR. This is table row. So then anything within that one particular row will be located within the opening and the closing TR tags. Now, to create the column information within each row, you need to use a different tag. There are actually two different tags that you can use. One is TH and one is TD. Now, TH is essentially a header tag for a table. It automatically centers and bolds the text for you that is within the TH tag, whereas the TD tag will show normal text and it will be left aligned instead of center aligned. Now, the TD and the TH tags work just like all of these other tags. You have an opening tag and you have a closing tag with them. So what you can do is to add in the information that you would like to be in your table. Each column that you would like to be in your table, you simply add in another set of TH or TD tags. This example right here, this will create a table with one row and then two columns in it. This will be one column and this will be the next column. And this represents the entire first row. So now, I will add in, just to help you identify where all of this information is. This is the same example that I have added in to my my guidebook that I created for this particular lesson. I have duplicated the first row to create a second row. And as you can see, it goes directly below it outside of the closing table row tag, and I create a new one, and then when my table is done, it's closed off by the closing table tag. So now when I update these changes on my site, you can see the table created down here with my text aligned up where it is supposed to be. I have one row and two rows and one column and two columns. Now, the actual, all the borders and everything for your tables, There is a way to control that using only HTML coding. However, this system is fairly limited in what it can do, and CSS can override your HTML rules for your particular table. You can see I added border 1, border equal to 1 onto this. That should actually add a 1 pixel border around the table and also within each of the table cells as well. However, on this particular site with the Weaver 2 theme, Weaver 2 actually has table CSS coding that is going to control exactly how these are designed, and they actually offer a couple of different options as far as that's concerned. So at least on this particular WordPress site where I am now, the border attribute for tables will not actually do anything. However, on a lot of your websites, it could be completely different if your theme on your WordPress site, for example, doesn't have any CSS coding for your tables. Now, to expand on tables just a little bit more, there's actually a number of attributes that you can use within your tables to change the way they look and operate. One of these is called column span or row span. Now, column span is actually just the abbreviation COL, so it's COL span, and COL span is a tag attribute. So you simply have an equal symbol and then your quotes, and then the value of that attribute will go in between the quotes. And what column span and row span do is this lets you define exactly how much space, how many cells in your table this one particular bit of information will take up. Typically, information will only take up one cell. A cell might be, you know, it's the intersection of a row and a column. So row 1, column 1 would typically be the only amount of space that this would take up. But when I add a column span of 2 onto this, what this is doing is it's saying that this particular cell is actually going to take up 2 columns worth of space instead of just 1 column worth of space. So what I could actually do is remove this second column here from the first row that I created, because both of my columns for that row are located right here already built into one. So this is going to be my row 1 text that spans for 2 columns. Now, another thing that I can do is to actually change the size of my columns. I can set a width and a height, or either one or even both of them. I could set this on my entire table tag. I could set it on my table row tags, or I can even set this on individual cells within my table. So this gives you a lot of control over the size of your table and the different parts of the table. So now I'm just going to add a simple height to this particular one so you can see exactly how this works. And I'm going to also change this into a table header instead. Now I'm going to drop down onto the second row here. And this time I'm going to change the first column also into a table header, except this time I'm going to use the command row span instead of column span. And I will go ahead and set a width yet again, and this time I'm going to set a width using a percentage instead of a number. Now the percentage refers to the total width and height that your table will occupy. So I want this particular column in my table to occupy a total of 33% of the overall width of the entire table, which means that the remaining column would then end up occupying the remaining 67% of the width. So this will make one of my columns small and allow the other one to be large. But now the row span that I added here, this is telling the this particular cell that I want it to take up a total of two rows worth of space instead of just one row worth of space. So now this particular field will actually be row 2 and row 3. But with column 1 information. Now over here, this is still row 2 and column 2. I'm actually going to drop down one more time and create a third row on this table now. Now for this third row, because I have a cell up here that is taking up two rows already, I want to simply omit one of my columns from this row because that column already exists right here. So this particular cell that I have down here will actually be row 3 and the second column. Even though it is within this particular row, it's listed as being the only HTML, the only cell that is actually located in this row. However, you will see that when I view this on the live web page, that is actually different because of the column spans and the row spans. Now for this particular theme, you can see that the text has gotten bold by adding it as a header, but it's not actually centering all of this text for me, but it has added a background color for me. Now once again, all of this, these special designs, all of this is being done by CSS coding and not my actual HTML table coding. And this particular Weaver theme offers a number of different ways that you can change this to where your tables would get designed in a different manner. This just happens to be, this is probably the default table design that Weaver does here. But the main point is that this first row here, it now actually spans both columns. There's not a second column worth of information here. If I were to force CSS to center align this text right here, it would be showing up more or less right around here instead. You can see over here, this particular one is actually taking up two rows. This is where I used row span. So now this occupies two rows, and then the other cells that were located in that table, they are just standard one cell tags within my table. So using a combination of heights and widths and column spans and row spans, you can actually create tables that really will end up looking like pretty much anything you would like for them to look like. They're really easy to customize in terms of you know, how you would like them to operate on your live website. Now, if anybody has questions about tables, feel free to go ahead and ask them, and I will get to those questions. And if not, I will go ahead and proceed on to the last section here that I would like to discuss tonight, which there's a decent amount of information here to go over, and this is on HTML forms. Now, a form actually provides you a way to ask your website visitors for some type of information. Just as a very basic example of a form, you can actually find on all WordPress websites by default the little search bar up here in the top. You have this search bar and then you have a button that goes along with it. This is an HTML form. This is a text box and this is a button that goes with the form. Now, what you can do is then create processing scripts that will actually take the information from your forms and do other things with that information. For example, if you wanted to ask people for their name and email address, for example, you could collect that information. When they click on the button to submit the form, it then sends that information to a processing script, and that script can then save that information for you in a database, for example. Now, I will be revisiting this forms tutorial in 2 more weeks when I get to the PHP tutorial, because I will actually be showing you guys how to create your own processing script for use with HTML forms. So you will have an entire concept here that you guys can use on your live websites with forms. Now, just like any of the other HTML tags that I have discussed, this is also a tag that needs an opening and a closing tag. The tag name of form, and then everything that is contained within the form simply goes in between these two tags. Now, the form tag has a couple of different attributes that you can use. One of these attributes is called the action attribute. Now, the action attribute is actually specifying the processing script that you would like to use for this form. If you have PHP coding built into the same page on your website where the form is built, you can leave off the action, because action will automatically use the existing web page address by default if it is left out. However, if your processing script is anywhere else besides on this same web page where you are building the form, then you will need to use the action attribute to tell the form where to send the form information when somebody clicks on the button to post that form. So just as an example, let's say I created a PHP script on one of my websites and uploaded it, and I will call this like formprocessing.php. So if this is where my PHP file was, that would be the processing script for this form, then I just type in the URL for it right here, and then when somebody submits the form, it'll send all the information for it to this website address right here. And the URL does not actually have to be a page on your own website. You can actually do form posts to other websites. In most cases, there's not a lot of practical uses for that type of thing. But people will make automated software solutions sometimes, for example, that will actually automatically post, for example, login information to a particular website for you to help navigate through that website. But in most cases, at least for the purposes that you guys will be using it for, you guys should have these processing scripts on your own websites. Now, the next attribute that I would like to talk about for forms here is the method attribute. Now, there are actually two different methods that you can use. You can use either get or post. Now, the easiest way to explain the difference between these two methods here is to simply show you the website address of this administration page that I am on right now. Notice at the beginning of this address right here, it goes up through this this PHP file right here called post.php. Now at the end of that, there's a question mark, and following the question mark is a series of other information. This is actually a series of variables and values for those variables. You have a variable called post, and the value is 50. A variable called action, and the value is edit. A variable called message, and the value is 1. This is an example of the get method. When you post form information using the get method, it will automatically take all of the different parts, all of the information within your form, and it will send it all to your processing script using these URL variables right here. Now, in a lot of cases, I typically recommend for people to use the other method, which is posting and not get. Post will not actually use these variables up here. It sends the variables to the actual web page itself instead of including it within the URL here. Now the main difference in between these two methods is a lot of times the compatibility issues that you may experience. If you have a lot of form information to be sending along, if the total length in characters of the form names and the values exceeds a certain length, I believe it's 1,024 characters, if I'm not mistaken, then it will just simply chop off the information and not actually include everything. So using the post method instead of the get method, you can avoid that problem. And you also don't have to worry about information in your form being altered so that it can work properly as a website address. For example, you can't have a space in a website address. So the form information will actually convert any non-URL friendly characters into a URL friendly version. So all of your spaces might be converted into a percentage sign 20, which actually represents a space within a website address. So if you're using the get method, then you will a lot of times have to undo all of those processing changes to your information to actually get the information as the user entered it on your web page. So for all of those reasons combined, I highly recommend only using the post method unless you have a really good reason to be using the get method, for example. Now, basically what I'm going to do here is to run through a series of different fields, which are HTML tags that you can use within your form to ask your website visitor for various amounts of information. Now to start with, I actually want to show you one of these. This is using an HTML tag called input. This is a self-closing tag, so you will not have to have a separate closing tag to go along with it. Now I am using the attribute called type with this particular tag, and I'm going to set the type to hidden. And now for the name, which is the name is another attribute to use. All of your form elements where you are asking people for information, they will all need a name attribute. Now, the value that you give that attribute should be different for each of the different form elements on any given page of your website. So, for example, for this one, I'm going to call this first name. Another very important thing to remember is you don't ever want to use spaces in your name values for these. Use hyphens, use underscores, use lowercase letters, capital letters, even use numbers if you want to, except just don't use other characters and don't use spaces, and you should be okay there. Now, the last part of this particular tag is the value attribute. And the value attribute simply tells the value for this particular variable in the form. As an example, for this particular field, I'm going to add the name Ryan as the first name. Now, just to show you exactly what this would do, if I was posting this form using the get method, so all this information ended up in my website address, when I posted this form, it would actually add something like this to my URL. You can see the name right here that I gave my tag, and then you can see the value on the other side of the equal sign. And this basically says that the variable by this name right here, first name, is equal to this value. So what this is doing is, you know, it is passing this information along, but with this particular type of tag, with this hidden HTML form tag, your website visitors are not actually going to see this information. If they view the source code on the page, they can see this information, so do not ever put sensitive information here thinking that they can't see it if they really wanted to be able to see it, but the point is that it won't display actually on your live website. So sometimes you may have information for perhaps a registered user on your website, and maybe you want to include some of that information in a form that they are filling out, but maybe it's not information that you actually need them to alter in any way. For those situations, you can use these hidden fields, and it will automatically post or send this information along to your processing script for you, and your website visitors will basically never know it is there. Now, the next type of form element that I would like to show you also uses the input tag, just like I was doing here. Now, you can actually use this entire line just like I have typed it in already with only one minor change, and that is to change the value of the type attribute right here. Instead of hidden, I want to use text. And what text is going to do is it's going to actually make this field visible on my web page and allow the user to enter in their own value for it. So this simplifies everything. Let me scroll down to the bottom here so you can see this. You can see there is a text box now with the name Ryan already pre-filled in it. Now, if you don't want your forms to pre-fill have, you know, information already entered in within it, you still can include the value right here, and you just leave it blank. Just simply type in two quote marks and just leave nothing in between it. And then you'll simply be creating a blank text box. It'll come up looking just like this. So obviously, this simple text input can really be used for a bunch of different purposes. One of the other attributes that you can use along with it is the size attribute. You just assign a number to it, and this actually controls the overall width of the text box that you have created. So, for example, if you only wanted somebody to provide you with a short amount of information, let's say you're just asking for a number 1 through 10, you might not need a really long text box. You might just want to create a really short text box. And so you do that by using this size attribute. Now for this example, I've refreshed it and you can see that my size that I set on it of 32, this actually made it larger than the default value. Now the default value can vary from one website to the next because that is also something that can be controlled by CSS coding. So it is possible for your it is possible for your site to actually be slightly different from this. Yes, Will. First name is a variable that I created for this particular form. It is the variable name of this particular field here. And so then when this form is sent along to the processing script, this will be the variable name that is used to reference the value that the user has entered in for this particular field. As I was showing you before, like it could be up in the website address if you are using the get method. If you are using the post method, it's only accessible through PHP coding, for example, and I'll be getting into more details on that in 2 weeks when I do the PHP lesson. But just to show you, for example, when you are using the get method and your variables are showing up in your website address, you actually access those variables using a global, the get global. So then you type in a $ underscore get, and then in between these quote marks right here is where your variable name would go. So first name would go right here, and this would tell you the value of first name if it was using the get method. Now if you're using the post method, then your variables are under the post global instead of the get global. And once again, I will be covering this in a lot more detail in 2 weeks for you guys, but that at least shows you how those variable names end up being used on the back-end processing script, for example. Now, the next thing I want to show you here is another HTML tag. It's very similar to the one that I just created here, this text box, except for this example, I want to create something that allows for a larger amount of text input. I'm specifically referring to more than one line worth of text input. So instead of using an input tag to do this, I'm actually going to use the text area tag. Now, text area is one of the form tags that is not self-closing. You must have an opening and a closing tag to use with text area. Now, the actual text, if you want to define default text to show up in this larger text box, that text actually goes in between the tags, just like it was a link tag, for example. So then the rest of your information would actually go in the opening tag here. You would have text area, and then you assign a name to it. Obviously, I don't want to use the same name. I might just call this something like user comments. Maybe I want people to have a larger text box where they could type in a few sentences or paragraphs worth of information that they could send to me. So the text area would be how I would collect that information. Now, there are two other attributes that you can use along with this, rows and columns. Columns is actually spelled C-O-L-S, just as an abbreviation. It's not actually the full word. Rows and columns as attributes. And now all you simply have to do is to provide a number for each of these attributes, the rows and the columns attribute. The number that you provide for rows will be how many rows, one on top of the next, worth of input space will be shown within this text area. And the columns is the number of columns going across the page. So the more rows you give your text area, the taller the text box will be. And the more columns you give your text area, then the wider it will be. So setting this as 5 rows and 60 columns, I'm going to update these changes to show you what this looks like on the live page here. You can see I get a much larger text box than the one that I had before. Now, most browsers actually offer something down here in the corner. You can see if I hover over the corner of this text box, I can actually change the size of it. I can actually drag it to make it larger or even to make it smaller if I want to. But that is not something controlled by HTML. It is controlled by your browsers instead. Now, once again, if I want to have a predefined value for the text area, this goes in between the two tags. The text area tag does not get a value attribute. The value simply goes in between the tags here. So just as an example, I'll type in my name here just so you can see where I've typed in my name. It adds that text into the text box for me. So now, the next example that I'm going to show you guys is how to create a drop-down box. Now, a drop-down box is using an HTML tag called select. You need an opening and a closing select tag, just like we did with text area. And everything contained within that drop-down box will be located in between these select tags. Is that how they add instructions like type name here, for example? And you're talking about into the form elements, like if the form element is already pre-filled with some information and it says type name here, for example, and then yes, that's correct. Now, obviously, if it does pre-fill information, but it's not one of those examples where it shows you information and then you click on it and the information that was pre-filled in there disappears. I've seen that on a lot of websites before, and I'm wondering if that may actually be what you're talking about. If you want the text to actually disappear when you click on it, you'd have to use some JavaScript coding to do that. You would essentially want to if you click away and don't make any changes to it, then it'll come back typically. That's all done with JavaScript coding. You basically set an event that will fire when somebody clicks on it, or it gets the focus, and then it clears it out. And then if no changes were made and you click away from it, then it restores it. I can put together a basic example of that for one of the upcoming lessons for you, Will. Even though I'm not really doing a dedicated detailed lesson on JavaScript, that one particular JavaScript would be fairly easy to program. Let's see, returning to my select field here. A select field, once again, is a drop-down box. Now, each of the available options within a drop-down box that you would like to have available for somebody to choose, they are controlled by using another HTML tag within your select tags, and this is the option tag. Now, for those of you that would like to keep things maybe easier to understand, if it works better for you, you can automatically add a closing option tag. However, this is actually one particular tag where the closing tag is not entirely necessary. If you omit the closing tag, it will actually automatically add it in for you in the browser, not something that WordPress is doing. Your option receives the value, whereas the select is receiving the name attribute. So for this example, I might call this one user answer as the name, and then for option I would set a value, and I could set this to a value of yes, and then I could have another one set to a value of no. Now, the reason why the option tag is not a self-closing tag is because the text that your website visitor sees in the drop-down box is not actually the value right here. This is one of the few examples where the value of your HTML field will not actually be shown with that particular element. You actually want to have the visible value that your website visitor sees on the outside of your option tag. And if you are using the closing tag, then it would actually go in between the opening and the closing tag. However, once again, the closing tags are actually optional. So I can actually delete that, copy this again, create a second option for no without using any closing option tags, and this right here is completely functioning HTML code to create a drop-down box where you have two options, a yes and a no. Now, let's say you wanted to have one of these options automatically selected by default in your form. Now, by default, the option on the very top will actually be selected automatically. However, you can choose to have another one selected by default by simply adding in the attribute selected. Now, this attribute is a little bit different from all the other attributes that I've discussed because there is no value to go along with it. It is nothing more than an attribute name put inside of the tag. You just add the word selected inside of one of your opening option tags, And then that option in the drop-down box will be the default selected value when a visitor first looks at that form. And then obviously they could change it to the other option if they wanted to. Now just to clarify here, the value that you have used for an option and the display text for the option, this does not have to be the same. I can have the values as a Y and an N and have the full word out here to the side because this is what the website visitor will actually see. They won't be seeing these values right here. So I'm going to update this here so you can see what this does on the live website. As you can see, this created a drop-down box for me. By default, no is selected, even though yes was the value on top. And, you know, somebody could simply change the value that they would like to choose for that particular input. Now, the final piece to creating a completely working form, something that people can enter in the information and then actually send that information to your processing script, you need one last HTML tag, and that is to create the actual submit button. Now, the submit button looks almost identical to your hidden inputs or your text box input tags. It also uses the input tag, and the type is simply changed to submit this time instead of text or hidden like it was for the previous ones. Once again, you set a name for it. I'll call this one like user save. And then the value will be the text that is displayed on this particular button on the website. So I'm going to update these changes and go back to the site here. And you can see that I now have a save button. So now when I enter in information here in the form and then click on the save button, then it will automatically send me along to the processing script. And send along this information that I entered into the form here once I click on this button. So the button is an essential part of every HTML form, unless you're using JavaScript, for example, which could automatically save changes in your form for you if you're only using HTML and PHP together. The submit button is an absolute necessity. One of the last things that I would like to talk about for forms, even though I already created a completely finished form that could actually be used in a functioning manner, obviously when you look at this form, it's confusing. If a website visitor were to come to a page that contained this form right here, they wouldn't have a clue in terms of what information they should be entering in for each specific text box or field input that you have provided for. So the way you can change this is by using another tag here within your form, and this is the label tag. The label tag has an opening and a closing tag, and then in between the label tag, you simply type in text that will help the user to identify what information is being asked for here. So for this example, I would use first name with the first name field. And so that tells people that I am asking for their first name here. Now, the reason why you actually want to use this label tag instead of just simply typing text to go next to this is because label actually has one additional feature to it. If you add in an attribute called for, and then you assign it a value, you can actually turn this into a clickable label. Now, just to show you how this works here, the value that goes in the for attribute should be the name value from the corresponding HTML field. So for this one, since this goes along with the first name field right here, I want this label to be for first name, label for first name. So now when I update this on my live website, you can see that this actually provides a label to go along with it. But not only that, the key difference between using a label and just standard text is that on most sites, if you actually click on the label, it will then automatically highlight the field for you here to begin typing in. So this is really it's just a design sort of thing to make your sites more user friendly, so people know what information to enter and where to enter it. So then you could proceed through each of these different parts here, and I could create a question for this particular yes and no answer. Have you ever done this before? You're looking for a yes and no answer. And then you change the label name to match up with it. And then you could set this one as comments. And you change the label to match up with the comments as well. So now when I update this page one more time here for you, you can see that the form begins to make a little bit more sense now, because there are labels that actually go along with each of the different sections here. Now, as you can see, some of these labels, like this one, for example, it actually didn't show up immediately above my drop-down box here. And the reason why it did that, you can see when I refresh the page how it is now showing up directly above it. The reason why it did that is what I was talking about earlier this evening, the auto paragraph tag. Since I had this HTML spread out over multiple lines, WordPress was automatically adding paragraph tags to my form HTML coding, and this was actually resulting in some extra blank space down here than what I was actually looking to have included in my form. So once again, the auto paragraphing part of WordPress is something very, very important to pay attention to. If you ever notice that the spacing that you're going after on your live site isn't quite what you thought it was going to be, 9 times out of 10, it is the auto paragraph feature of WordPress that is causing that problem. That pretty much covers the extent of the information that I am covering this evening. If you guys have additional questions, please feel free to ask them. I don't mind sticking around for a while and asking any questions that you might have about anything I've gone over tonight, or even if there's something specific about HTML maybe that you were looking to find out that I did not cover. Now, once again, next week I will be continuing with CSS. That is going to be also on Tuesday of next week, starting again at 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, and that will be the obviously the third lesson in this series. Now I've sent out some emails over the last couple of days about my next upcoming webinar series that I'm going to be running after this technical webinar series is over. I'm actually going to then be moving on and actually building an Amazon website for you guys live throughout the course of a series of webinars. Typically, I would honestly not even bother mentioning one of my upcoming classes to you guys here within this class. But the one reason why I thought it was worth mentioning is simply because at midnight tonight, the price on that future one is going to be doubling. I was trying to give my existing customers an opportunity to get in on this at a cheaper price, and then when I actually sell access to it to the general public, then I'm going to be charging double what I am looking to, you know, offering my customers for a particular deal. Now that whole series, there's actually two different options from it. Sure, Stan, I can send you a link for that. The next webinar series that I will be doing, there's two different options, one of them being cheaper than the other one, but the more expensive option has some personal coaching time with me built in, email consultations. Let's see, I believe this is the link for the offer that includes the email consultations, and then the cheaper option that is just the webinars and the guidebooks, and actually some of my software developers licenses for some of my plugins as well, because I'm going to be teaching people how to actually flip websites that they build. So the general intention is to follow along through the webinar, build an Amazon site with me as I build one for you guys, and then at the end of the webinar, I'm going to teach you how to turn around, take that site and sell it off on Flippa or the Warrior Forum, and make at least double what you've put into the coaching program, if not more so. My links don't work. Oh, I see. I'm sorry about that. I've missed a letter on the end of my domain name. Sorry about that, guys. I have two different computers. I have a home computer, and then I have an office computer. And my keyboards are completely different on the two computers, something I've been meaning to change for a while now. And so I get used to one, and then I move over to another computer, and my typing goes bad pretty quickly until I get used to it again. I don't believe I've seen any questions. Anybody have questions about anything I was discussing tonight? You know, anything HTML related that you'd like for me to answer? I saw you started typing in something, Will, that said general question, but I didn't see a question to go along with that, though. Oh, there it is. I spoke too soon. Okay, Will is asking, he says that sometimes he wants to change the text on an existing WordPress page, but he's not sure which file it is in. He's asking if there's a general rule for finding a particular text in order to get that updated. Now, are you referring to are you referring to text that might be, for example, default text that is built into your theme, Will? Like, for example, on this particular page, like this text right here above my content, this isn't actually in my page content. This is controlled by my theme, for example. So I was curious if this is what you're actually referring to, is changing text that is outside of your main page content. Is that what you're talking about? I guess assuming that is true. Down here under appearance, if you go down to the editor, you can actually edit particular parts of the theme that you are using, which will typically control the various text output areas of your website. If you find that you just simply cannot, it never has the text I'm looking at, it could be one of a number of things causing that, Will. You can see here as I look through Weaver 2, for example, all the different pages that are available here. You have, like, this page is called content, but then you have a bunch of different variations of it: aside, audio, blank, chat, gallery, HTML. Sometimes there are different types of posts on your site. Let me edit this one for you real quick, just so I can show you. For example, over here under template, you can see that there's a bunch of different options. Depending on the options that you are using for the display, or even down here, if you have different sidebar layout combinations, then it can actually have numerous different files over here that all represent essentially the same area of your site, but these different files may be used in different situations. For example, for the different template types, there might be a separate one of these. You can see page with post, page template, raw page template, sitemap page template, two column content page template. Depending on the theme, sometimes they're named like this, so they're easy to identify. Other times, they are not. I would look for a page.php file first to start with, Will, and then look and see if there are other variations of that page file. And this would probably be the most likely place to find it, but then again, it can heavily depend on where the text is at on your particular page. For example, if you're viewing your live page and the text appears that you're wanting to change, let's say it's up at the top of your site, then it's most likely not going to be found in one of these page.php files. It would most likely be found in a header file, for example. There is a header.php and a footer.php that should be found in any given theme that is out there. So there is a standard file naming structure for creating these theme files, but ultimately, I guess there's no simple way to say, go straight to this page and this is where you will find it, because themes can be highly customized and have all these different templates that go along with them. Sort of, Will. If you're within one of these individual pages, then you can actually use your browser, for example, to search for a particular amount of text. You know, let's say you were searching for this text. You could find it, and it'll highlight it within the content. The only problem with that is that you can only do this on a page-by-page basis. You won't actually be able to search through all of the files. Now, if you are looking to search through all of the files, if there's like some text that you just absolutely cannot find anywhere and you are looking to change that, what you could do is using FTP, for example, you could download the entire theme or plugin from your website to your local computer, and then you can actually use software on your computer to quickly search through not just one file, but all the files at the same time. I actually like to use a program called Notepad++. It's free. I use this for all of my programming, HTML, CSS, JavaScript, PHP. It doesn't matter. It works with all of them. And there is a search function within Notepad++ where you can specify, say, a directory on your local computer and tell it to search all the files in that directory. I agree, Will. When Windows 8 search has not gotten much better, honestly. I think Windows 8 is essentially Windows 7 repackaged with some cute little bells and whistles. Yeah, it is. I have one computer using Windows 7 and one using Windows 8, and I have been seriously tempted to go out and buy another copy of Windows 7 and replace my Windows 8 with it. Yeah, definitely sticking with Windows 7. Hopefully they'll come along and create something a little better once they come out with the next version of Windows. But I was not very impressed with Windows 8. Anybody else have questions for me, guys? If not, I will go ahead and call it a night. And once again, next week at 7 p.m., same day, Tuesday night, we will be having the next Techie Masterclass, which will be covering CSS coding. Sure, Will. It's just called Notepad++, like with the actual symbols, and not words. It's completely free. I think you can just go to Google and just type Notepad++. It's notepad++.org right here, where you can download that. Completely free, open source. It's actually a SourceForge project, I believe, just for Microsoft Windows. I don't think it is for Macs. Prices? Are you referring to the Amazon coaching, Will? The difference in the pricing there. The more expensive one is essentially going to have email consultation time built in, and this would be private email consultation directly with me, both before the program actually begins, like all the live webinars, I'd like to exchange a few emails and, you know, find out where people stand and what they're looking to learn. And not only that, but actually help them out with some specific guidance in terms of, you know, the direction that they are looking to be taking. And then there is a second email consultation for that one that will be after the entire webinar series is over. And the point of the follow-up email consultation is to check back in with you and ensure that you were able to make it through the coaching program good and build these sites. And then I would actually like to review the site that you build with this training course at the end, and you know, provide you some feedback on it. Yes. Basically, I'm going to be building the Amazon site using WordPress. Yes, and also how to flip them. At the very end, my last training session, I'm going to teach you guys how to flip websites. I've actually sold $52,000 worth of websites on Flippa.com alone. Not to mention sites that I've sold outside of Flippa through private contacts or through the Warrior Forum. That is since early 2011. Will was the first time I sold a site there. So about 2.5 years. But then again, site flipping is not my primary focus by any means. It's really just something I have done on the side. I've sold off some of my own websites. I've sold off some of other people's websites as well. Tried, you know, with helping them sell off. What does a typical Amazon site get? On how average long does it take? It'll depend a lot on how much time you have, for example, every day to put into building a site. I can sit down in 3 or 4 days maybe and build a complete Amazon site from start to finish. But then again, I'll be putting in a full day's worth of work each of those days. However, if you have, for example, maybe an hour or two every day to work on it. Most people can typically build a 20-page site in a month or less, which I feel like is a very reasonable amount of time to construct a site. Your first one may take a little bit longer, but once you get familiar with the process behind it, it goes a lot quicker. If I were to sit down and do nothing but build Amazon sites my every waking moment, I could easily build 5 to 10 of them every month. And then how long would it take to sell on average? You can typically sell them once they are making some kind of money. You can try to sell them before they start to make money, but you're not going to earn as much with them. The whole reason that a lot of people are on Flippa looking to buy sites is because they're looking to buy pre-built sites that are already up and earning some type of income. So in that regards, it is once the site starts making income. However, that can happen very quickly, or it could obviously end up never happening if you were to build a site that couldn't get traffic to it in some way. But on average, I will typically be able to get my sites with traffic to them and referring sales in no more than about 3 to 4 months max. However, sometimes it happens as quickly in a couple of weeks. One particular site, actually the very, very first Amazon site that I ever sold, and actually the first Amazon site that I shared with other people as well, it was a site that I shared in a post that I made on the Warrior Forum back in 2010. The site was dogcratesizes.com. And the simple act of sharing that one site on the Warrior Forum actually is the entire reason why I'm really sitting here now talking to you guys. It made me realize that the knowledge that I had, that there was a big demand for it in the marketing industry. A lot of other people started saying, you know, hey, I want to know how to build a site like this, and I want to know how to build advertising like the ads that you created on the site. And so it was all that stuff that kind of jump-started my Amazon product development career, so to speak. But that one particular Amazon site, which was only 20 pages in size, I sold it exactly 6 weeks to the day after I registered the domain name, and I sold it for $3,000. However, I do believe that might be a little bit of a high side estimate for that time period, in terms of, I definitely do not think it is reasonable for everybody to expect to build a site and 6 weeks later flip it around for $3,000. However, it's very realistic if you can get a site to earn even $50 to $100 a month, then you can easily flip those sites for $1,000, $2,000 is a very reasonable asking price for a site that is making regular money. Essentially, you take your monthly profit from the site and multiply it by 18. This gives you a year and a half worth of profit on the site. And that should be your asking price on the site. So if you're making, you know, you have a site that's making $100 a month, ask $1,800 for it, for example. Let's see. Let me make sure I've got all these answered for you, Will. Yes, I cover traffic too. I will be talking about Facebook and Squidoo and YouTube and Google Plus in this series, and teaching you guys all that I know about those websites and how you can utilize them to bring in traffic to your Amazon websites. And that would be in addition to traffic that you may be able to get off of search engine visitors, for example. Sure, that would be fine, Will, if you'd like to talk in private for a moment after this is over. I guess whatever works better for you, really. It doesn't make a lot of difference. I could do Skype or Facebook or email or whatever. Okay. If you would like to just give me your name on there, I can send you a contact request after this is over with, and talk to you there for a few. Okay. You're welcome, Will. Maybe give me about 10 or 15 minutes or something, and I will be over there and talk to you for a few. Any other questions, you guys, before I call it a night here? It looks like a majority of people have gone ahead and left. Still got a couple people hanging around, so I just want to make sure none of you other guys have any questions for me. If not, if you come up with anything in the meantime, you guys are more than welcome to contact me, send me a message on Facebook or something if you would like. Here's my Facebook information. Again, I can leave this up for just another minute or so. And if not, then I will be seeing all of you guys next Tuesday night, same time again, 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. And we will be doing the CSS class then. I hope all you guys have a great night. Thanks again for joining me, and I will see you all next week.